My name is Michael Baderson, and I have been away from the channel for quite a while now. Now that we've discussed that thoroughly though, this is Sony's PSVR2 PC adapter, or as I like to call it, the PSPCVR2. It's quite a handful. A while back, I took a look at the PSVR2, Sony's second generation PlayStation VR headset. And though I had a limited amount of time with the headset, I enjoyed it. It was a great headset, and I would have definitely used it myself if I owned a PS5. This is where I personally struggled with the PSVR2 at the time. I own a PC, I own a couple VR headsets. Fake even let me break his 1995 example of pure, true Nintendo innovation.
Okay, I feel like I'm breaking shit.
I did not own a PS5. Fast forward to now though, and I own a PS5. And a PSVR2 headset. A tiny little ecosystem that allows me to do glorious specific things with glorious specific hardware. Wouldn't it be great then if there was like a way to get out of that ecosystem with said hardware? And Sony delivered just that. This magical box, or one of the devices of all time. Gone are the days of the PlayStation exclusive VR releases. Gone are the limitations of your console's graphical power. We now have another contender for uncompressed raw visual juice being fed straight to your eyeballs through surprisingly outdated lens technology, OLED panels, and a Halo head strap, and the first hurdle I had to overcome the moment I bought this thing. Even before I could set up the adapter properly, I quickly found out that I needed a DisplayPort 1.4 cable, and due to the little box or my PC not having any Bluetooth capabilities, a Bluetooth dongle. Though I could think of a reason or two to add Bluetooth capabilities to the PC adapter itself, I should also have at least considered the possibility that the lack of Bluetooth on my PC would bite my rear at some point in my career. And a DisplayPort cable is fair enough. It saves on the cost of one unit, and some even have a cable lying around already that would work just fine with this. It's just that the spending of more money after already having spent money felt a bit off on my experience overall. By the way, if you like seeing me suffer from a low bank balance, I suggest you subscribe, because this isn't the first and definitely not the last time I will spend money to make a video.
There are probably quite some people out there who are in the same exact situation as I am, but I also know there's some lucky people out there that don't even need to spend a single dime to get this to work. But more on that one later.
The spending of more money was sadly not the only hurdle I had to jump over on my road to another choice of PCVR headset. Luckily, it all started off pretty good.
PlayStation VR Sense controller, right. That's connected. Okay, that went actually pretty smoothly, I am not gonna lie.
The initial setup was actually not that difficult. It all went pretty much like a breeze all the way through for me. Though, I would have kind of liked to have the eye tracking back to visualize the headset position during your visual alignment stages of it all, because that just kind of really helped get the sweet spot on these Fresnel lenses back on the PS5. Also, if you did not know the eye tracking was not going to work on this adapter, you're in for a wild ride. Regardless of the lack of eye tracking, the setup actually made me feel somewhat confident this would all go really well.
VR headset camera can't track your surroundings. Why?
It's a shame that the first thing happening after was an insane lack of performance due to something really dumb, small, and probably relatively easy to fix in the software side of things.
Oh my god, what the hell is going on? Why?
You see, my PC can handle quite a lot. It may not be a 4090 or anything, but the 4070 Ti that could would definitely punch its way through pools of pixels oozing into the various headsets I've tried over the years. For exactly that reason, this headset caught me massively off guard when it seemed to struggle with 45 FPS in a game like H3VR, and wouldn't even run properly whatsoever on something like iRacing. In the end, I found out it was just SteamVR seeing the headset's base resolution as something with almost twice as many pixels as the PSVR2 should physically have, and with my super sampling settings, it tried to run something like a super sampled Apple Vision Pro, so as much as my PC could do, it just couldn't do that. All I had to do was manually set the resolution much closer to the actual pixel count of the PSVR2 itself, and I would be all good to go.
You know what we're gonna do? We're not gonna show that.
Fun fact, I did actually try this fix as one of the first things I did on the day, but as I was doing my testing on that day on this one specific track in iRacing, which currently has a couple performance malfunctions, I didn't find out about what the actual inherent problem was till the day after. So I guess I'm just like dumb and unlucky.
It all started coming together. A working headset and a happy Michael finally able to play his favorite PCVR games all with a PSVR2. The deep black levels of the OLED panels were doing wonders to the grim setting of Half-Life Alyx, even though it did not have HDR capabilities anymore. And the overall feel that I quite like from the controllers were a nice addition to games like H3VR and VTOL VR, even though they don't have adaptive triggers anymore. And the Halo head strap design, together with the pretty good immersive audio solution and all its adjustability, was good to see on something tethered to a PC again, even though the headset haptics couldn't support bombastic scenes anymore.
You see, I told you you'd be in for a wild ride if you didn't expect all this.
All in all, the headset did now work on a PC. Yeah, I still had some issues with tracking on the controllers, and this might be something that is a Bluetooth dongle issue in the end, given Sony doesn't even guarantee them to work fully, but seeing as it was very rarely a thing for me, it meant that as long as I used it for the titles I wanted to play it with, I could live with all the missing features and the little bugs that may even be patched out at some point in the future. But just because I can live with it, does that mean you should too?
The PSPCVR2. It's a box that truly does what it says on the box. It pairs your precious PSVR2 to your prized PC, packed with palatable performance parts, turning your potential paperweight into a placeholder while you patiently wait for Valve's next promising project in the pipeline for PCVR. Yes, it did take quite some hours and some very hot summer days to make this all work properly. But in the end, you have a very satisfying OLED VR experience. As satisfying, if not better, than any of the other OLED VR experiences that I have personally encountered. Yes, it's nothing super fancy like a big screen beyond with the smallest headset out there, or anything like half the resolution of a modern Pimax or Vario headset. But once it's set up, it just works as a PCVR headset. Some bits have even improved, in my opinion. Now, we've always talked about the Mura in this headset, and as much as the technical design of the headset doesn't allow for that Mura to completely disappear anyway, it does feel like it is suppressed when it is hooked up to a PC. This might be because there's just a different force behind it super sampling the image. I don't know, but it seems to be a lot less than what I'm used to on the PSVR2. It just means that right now it all comes down to the cost. And I don't just mean all of the features that you're missing, the cost of all of the things that the headset used to be. It's also just the financial impact of making this thing work on your computer. I mentioned earlier that there are some people out there lucky enough that don't even need this adapter to make any of this work. If you own a Virtual Link port on your graphics card, you can probably just plug in your PSVR2 straight into it and you got everything going. As long as you have Bluetooth, of course. Otherwise, you're gonna need to buy that dongle and then it's gonna be costly again, and we're back to the whole thing. But most people are probably closer to my situation than to that situation, so I think it's only fair to at least take the cost of the adapter into account to really see if this is all worth it for you. If you are unlucky enough not to have a spare cable lying around and have no Bluetooth, you're gonna have to account for about 35 euros extra on top of that price to make it an almost 100 euro expense to make a 600 euro headset work on your already super expensive PC. If you are personally looking into a PSVR 2 solely for the purpose of hooking it up to your PC, I wholeheartedly recommend not to do that. I already owned a PSVR 2, and I already owned a device that it worked on, so I don't mind seeing if I could broaden and expand the use case of that PSVR 2. But if you want to try and order a PSVR 2 just to get it to work on PC, you're going to be spending almost 700 euros to get a PCVR headset. And for that price, there are things out there that can offer a lot more and a somewhat higher quality experience than what you've got over here. This is an option then for those that are already satisfied with the fact that they own a PS5 and a PSVR 2, and they just kind of want to see what else it can do. For what it is, it works. It just works. But man, do all the stars have to align perfectly for it to work well.